Authentication is a difficult topic to explore, right? There are so many terms floating around us, from 2FA to MFA to OTP and all those things together. It's kind of really difficult to make sense of what do you need and when. But authentication is everywhere, right? It doesn't matter what you do on the web, you're probably going to encounter some sort of authentication. Be it, you know, sending money to somebody in online banking, healthcare access to maybe to check your account or anything like that, check notifications, stuff like that. And also, in fact, even if you actually enter your complex building, maybe you have to type in the code, the PIN code and the gate as well to enter. So authentication really is following us everywhere we go. And sometimes it's seamless and sometimes it's just difficult. So let's try to observe and look at what is happening in terms of authentication, what a difficult word, on the web, and how we can create experiences that maybe do look a little bit more seamless to users who have to authenticate themselves. But ironically, when we think about authentication, we often think about one particular pattern. And that pattern is really complex password requirements. That really is it, right? Because every time we go to, you know, a really corporate environment maybe, have to actually follow those guidelines and have to really read them and try to really understand what is it that you're actually typing in there. For example, specifically here, you cannot use customer ID. And sometimes it's just a little bit difficult to kind of follow along. What have you done? What have you not done? It's kind of more like a game. And then sometimes it's essays, right? Magnificent essays about everything in life that you're allowed to do and what you're not allowed to do, right? So you cannot use previous passwords. The password must contain between 12 and 24 characters, case sensitive, and no character may be repeated in a sequence. They must include four types of characters, and your password needs to be more than 365 days old. Or maybe this is why we actually are changing password. Who knows at this point? And sometimes it's a lot of requirements right there. And then of course you also have to actually confirm it. I am wondering though, for one reason here, well, it says contains special characters except brackets, ampersand, equals, and whatever. Why is that? Well, who knows, we probably will never find out. But all of these examples are kind of very symbolic for this kind of slightly wrong paradigm about what we're doing on the web in terms of authentication and security. I think that very often when we think about those things, we kind of tend to think, well, how can we make authentication nicer? Right? How can we make this experience around passwords nicer, right? While also keeping it secure? And I'm wondering if it's actually the right approach in the first place. Because instead of making authentication nicer, we should probably just make it invisible. Because if nobody notices it and just kind of flawlessly happens every time you actually enter a page or a site or an application or whatever, then that's probably what we want to achieve. And we probably need to turn the kind of table around here. Because instead of favoring security against usability, which is often the necessity really, because we want to make sure that the data is protected, properly saved and stored and all of that. The problem is that very often when we make things too hard to use, right, but secure, users kind of find a way to trick the system, right? So Jared Spool had an incredible talk on fixing the failures of authentication UX a while back. And he said a couple of things that really stuck with me. So when I was exploring this notion of authentication UX, this really, really stuck vividly in my head. And he said, well, if a product is not usable, it's also not going to be secure. Because if it is difficult to use, and you have to remember remarkable kind of set of passwords and come up with them and use them in a very specific and twisted way, well, that's when people start using alternatives. Maybe instead of using corporate email accounts, they use private email accounts. Maybe instead of actually using a complex password manager, they just put passwords on sticky notes because they forget them all the time, right? So those things are, people are really good at those things, right? Kind of really twisting side around. And I think that we really have to think about usability prevailing over security while also keeping things, of course, secure. In fact, we can achieve both, but usability is probably going to be trumping security at this point. And all of that, and all the examples I mentioned before, they in some way remind me of this beautiful example of a randomized numpad, right? Obviously, if you want to prevent brute force attacks in your software application, you might want to randomize your numpad, and that might be a good idea for security, but usability-wise, that's probably a disaster, because this is just so incredibly difficult to use, and you have to really twist your mind around how to even use it. So, usability is maybe way more important than security to enable or to make possible security in the first place. And as Jared continued, well, we try to make it easy to use for people who should have access, but often make it totally unusable for people who don't have access. If you might, you know, remember yourself in a situation where your account is suspended, locked out, you cannot get in, the password recovery doesn't work, what can you do? 100% abandonment and probably a lot of stress along the way as well, right? So maybe when we think about security and we think about usability, we really need to think about stages and layers of authentication and of security. And a very good example of that is, you know, a very simple example really, this simple form. You might say, well, what's a big deal? It's just a regular form and has an input field for email and also has an input field for the password. So what's a big deal? Well, the issue is the error message, because the error message shows wrong email or password. Now, normally we could say, well, if the password is wrong, well, then we can say to somebody that the password is wrong, right? So they can know what to fix. Or if the email is not in our database, we can say, well, the email is not in our database, so the email is wrong. But here we are explicitly generic by design. And we are so because we need to favor security over usability. Well, at least that's what we tend to do most of the time. Because if we do communicate that the password is wrong, we're admitting that the email exists in the database. And if we do communicate that the email is wrong, right, then we kind of allow people to twist and try to kind of check other email accounts and to see if it's available or not. And that might be the information that the hacker might use then to steal some personal data or try to log in. So as a result, we are generic and our error messages are very generic as well, right? Here's another example of security questions, right? We all have seen them before. And this is one from United. And in United, you are being kind of presented with a couple of questions that you can select to answer, right? And then, of course, they are conveniently presented as drop-downs, so you don't even have to memorize, kind of to type it on your own, right? And, you know, that's okay. Well, what's your favorite type of movie? What's your favorite sea animal, right? But hold on, you actually have just like, what, 15 options to choose from if you want to crack somebody's account? That doesn't seem to be right. And just today I ended up in PayPal, kind of the same story, but at least here you can actually type in your answer. However, what happens in usability test, and that's quite interesting, is that people try to answer each question, doesn't matter what the question really is, with the same answer, just with the same particular keyword. It's basically their second password. Sometimes they would even repeat the actual password that they're using, ironically, when trying to type in the answer to the security question, right? So, you know, why do they do that? Well, because if they provide the right answer, maybe somebody who knows them well enough might be able to, you know, answer it for them or kind of guess the right answer. And that's what people don't want. And that's definitely not the state of the art today, and it's better to be avoiding things like that. Not to mention our beautiful, gorgeous, incredible CAPTCHAs, which I always see a little bit differently, maybe more like this, right? And of course, when we look into all these CAPTCHAs, and there is an incredible amount of research done on that, CAPTCHA's performance is just horrendous. It just doesn't work. On average, a user needs around 10 seconds to solve a text-based CAPTCHA, and it takes 28.4 seconds to solve the audio version. Notably, around 20% give up after a few tries. That's not very surprising. What's also really interesting, though, is that bots over the recent years got so advanced that it's now nearly impossible to generate images that are easy to solve for humans but unsolvable for bots. So AI can solve most difficult distorted text with almost 100% accuracy, while humans only with 33%. And there is a great study about all of that from 2018, right? Which is why, you know, regular CAPTCHAs as we know them, you know, from the past, definitely not worth it. Still, we have these beautiful things, and this is invisible CAPTCHA, and that seems to be working fairly okay, right? Except when it doesn't, because if it doesn't, it becomes a journey and exploration of street signs and fire hydrants and storefronts and crosswalks and all those things, which are just really, really confusing and, you know, take a lot of time. So for this particular thing, instead of using a CAPTCHA by default, we should be probably thinking about kind of the UX of it, right? So first of all, we could go ahead and really establish a spam prevention strategy, which is why we're using CAPTCHAs in the first place, right? So we would be blocking known spam IPs. We might be starting off with something that's very light, and it's usually a good idea. When you think about security, we start with something light and see if it's actually protecting us enough. And then we stop when we know that the protection is pretty high, right? So exceptions could be, for example, things like two-factor authentication, which is just a good default in general. But in this particular case, we might be starting with a random plain human question. What color is the sun? have people answering, right? Or use a honeypot technique where you actually have a kind of an empty input box, and then you say, oh, well, if it's a user, it's a some customer coming to the site, they will not see it because we will hide it. But usually a robot will just fill in everything with random strings, so we can track that. And if so, if that honeypot input field is has some data, well, that must be bot. We need to block them, right? We also can have a keyboard accessible slider to verify, right? So to make sure that somebody is human. We can also use time traps, maybe not allowing any clicks on any buttons within 1.5 seconds, maybe 3 seconds, maybe even 5 seconds, you know, to give people an opportunity to actually read an article or read a landing page, right? We also do a lot of other things, of course, but then CAPTCHA, as you can see here, right, it's pretty much the last method, because CAPTCHA creates, kind of solves the security issue for sure, but it also adds to some usability issues, which we probably don't want. Right? So in every situation like that, we need to be very, very careful. And there are plenty of situations like this. Just give us kind of a little bit of an overview. This is the world in which we're living right now, right? Where, you know, we make people's life difficult because of authentication, right? Where we require email confirmation to proceed because we don't trust them. We disable sign up for an already existing email if it's actually in the records already. We also have strict password requirements for people. So, you know, if their password is not good enough or their password manager's password is not good enough, then they kind of use that password and add those extra characters and then forget about those passwords or maybe forget to save them in the password manager. We require two-factor authentication, which is quite complex, can be quite complex too early. We require a brand new password setup because we don't allow to reuse old passwords. Whenever somebody's trying multiple times, we temporarily lock out that person from their account. We have all these puzzles in identifying images and storefronts and cars, CAPTCHA, generic error messages. And ultimately, all of these are examples of unloading our problems onto users, which is wrong. So let's see how we can fix that for good. And for that, let's explore what options we actually have around us, right? In terms of authentication, and in terms of just different little techniques that can help here and there.